Welcome to Love Fellowship Believers, a non-denominational church desiring to fulfill God's will. We invite you to join us in an atmosphere of praise and worship and the powerful teachings of Christ delivered in a most creative way that reaches every age. Located at 1900 Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard in Greensboro, North Carolina, on the wonderful campus of Gillespie Park Elementary School. This year, we're focusing on building a foundation solidified by grace, with walls made by faith, and our homes being filled with salvation by being united in living devotion. We promise you, visiting us online or in the sanctuary will be an experience that will be life-changing and one you'll never forget. We hope to see you soon. Services begin at 11 a.m. Have a blessed day.
Comes from Ephesians, the fourth chapter, beginning at the 11th verse, and we shall conclude at the 16th verse. Ephesians, the fourth chapter, beginning at the 11th verse, and we shall conclude at the 16th verse. Our second reading comes from the prophet Jeremiah's writing, the third chapter, the 15th verse.
The first reading, our children, to make sure that they take it down, and for some of us who may need a little more time, Ephesians, the fourth chapter, beginning at verse 11, and we shall conclude at verse 16. When you have it, would you please signify by saying amen.
Amen.
Amen. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning at the 11th verse. And these words are recorded there. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Verse 14, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking in truth, in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ. 16th and concluding verse, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in life. I want to read that particular scripture again. Verse 16, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Now, listen. The last word of this particular verse says in love, not in hate. Jeremiah 3:15. Jeremiah 3:15. According to the writings of Jeremiah, in that third chapter and the 15th verse, Jeremiah writes, according to what the Lord says. And I will give you shepherds or pastors according to my heart, who will feed you with knowledge and understanding. Jeremiah 3:15, and I will give you shepherds or pastors according to my heart, who will feed you with knowledge and understanding. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, we come to you in prayer this morning, this afternoon, Lord, to give you thanks for all that you've done, dear Lord, for all that you will do, Lord God, for all that you are still doing in our lives. Father, we thank you that you bless us and you didn't look down on us, dear Lord, that you looked beyond our faults and you saw our needs. Lord, we thank you that 7 years ago you allowed your servant to be able to see a path, oh dear God, that your people in this area needed you, dear Lord. Though things may not have always been good, rocky, sometimes, oh dear God, but yet through every storm, dear Lord, you blessed them and you kept them, Lord. So for that we say thank you. Now, Lord God, as we prepare to celebrate what you've done, bless us, oh dear God, to be on one accord. Help us, oh dear God, that you get the glory and no man, but that we get the victory. And through Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we may continue to be satisfied. And it is in the majestic name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Most High God. LFB, good morning to you. Kingdom Life and other family members, good morning to you. I just want to ask that you loosen up a little bit, if you would. Everything's all right. God is still in control, and he's still in charge of all things. On this morning, we came to celebrate what God has done through the season that has just passed. And that is a good thing, amen? Amen. See, one of the things that I like to ask you to do, I want you to walk with me, if you would. Would you walk with me a little bit? Can you talk back? Can you help me this morning as we prepare to do what thus saith the Lord? Will you do that for me? Amen. Amen. In our initial or first reading with our passage of scripture, and just in case we've got any scholars in the house, in our initial pericope, Brother Pastor, the Apostle Paul is telling us about the spiritual gifts that God has given, the expectations of those whom he has given them, and the purpose that he has given them, which are all intended that God gets the glory. In our foundational text, in the book bearing his name, at the 3rd chapter, the 15th verse, Jeremiah, the prophet, is the author. Jeremiah says the purpose of his writing is to urge God's people to turn from their sin and turn back to God. During Jeremiah's ministry, approximately 627 through 586 BC, it's written to Judah, or the southern kingdom, and its capital city, Jerusalem. But on this monumental and celebratory day, this particular passage of scripture is written and designed and will serve a purpose for LFB. God has blessed you with a gift. Church family, it's the pastor's anniversary. The pastor and his family. One of the things that we should never misunderstand is, because your pastor is in view of you, he's got a wife and children. Anything that happens with your pastor happens with his wife and children. Many times people don't understand that it is a sacrifice to the family when the pastor has got to go and take care of business. Far too many times in our churches, people play many games because I want the pastor's attention, because I need for the pastor to give me this. I need for the pastor to do that. The pastor is a man or a woman like anybody else. Stop shucking and jiving and playing games with your pastor. Now, I know somebody probably doesn't want to hear what I've got to say this morning, but I told you, we didn't bring any sugar. I just came to keep it real. The author of this text, the Apostle Paul, talks about many things in this particular writing. One of the things that the Apostle Paul didn't say, but that I want to tell you because I know and understand, is that God has blessed you all with a gift, a package deal, if you would. And just for a little while on this morning, if you would allow me to, if we were to use a title, if we looked at the two readings that we studied earlier on this morning, if we were to use a subject, it would be, God gave you a gift, love it. God gave you a gift, love it. Webster's definition of a gift: something given voluntarily without payment in return, as to show favor. Many of you may not understand what I'm saying. Many of you may not even believe me, but I encourage you to read it for yourself. Paul wrote, the apostle himself, when he talked about Jesus himself was giving gifts, and to some he gave apostles, some he gave teachers, some he gave pastors. But the gift that Paul is talking about, that Jesus gave your pastor a gift, and God gave that gift to you, LFB. You ought to be able to thank the Lord for having a gift on today. Now, see, many of you want to get quiet because it doesn't really mean much to you, because I hadn't come down your street. I'm going to preach in a minute. The scripture declares that gifts that are given from God, that I expect to yield positive spiritual results for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Washington, what are you trying to say? Well, that brings us to our first point. In the body of Christ, in our local refuge of fellowship, God has given us all gifts to use that we might be able to be strengthened in our Christian walk. Far too many times we want to run to the pastor for the pastor to do this and for the pastor to do that. But if we were to keep it real and in reality, the matter of the fact is, if you were working properly in your gift, you wouldn't have to run to the pastor for everything. And when you run to the pastor for this, because you want to lead a song, the minister of music says, no, you don't need to lead this song. You run to the pastor. Now the pastor's got to stop pastoring. He's got to come, and now he's got to play problem solver. You stop the pastor from pastoring because of you playing games. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. I did say playing games, because anytime someone is operating out of their gift, the only thing they're doing are playing games. And when you've got a game, the only thing you can do with a game is play a game. Stop messing with the pastor and let the pastor pastor. Pastor, I just wanted to tell you, I heard, I ain't said this though, Pastor. Don't tell nobody I told you, Pastor, but across town over there, they were talking about, you know, what's happening over here, you know, and Pastor, if you, I think we should do this, I think we should do that. God didn't give you a vision, he gave the vision to the pastor. Stop toting news and starting all kind of problems and situations. See, many times in the local church today, the reason we can't grow is because somebody's always got something going. Like Michael Jackson said, you just want to be starting something. But if anything, you've got a responsibility. Yeah, you got a responsibility too. God didn't say that the pastor's got to do all the work. The writer of the scripture declares that God has given us all gifts. Bring your gift to use for the edifying of the body of Christ. If God blessed you to be able to sing, sing to the glory of God. If God blessed you to be able to usher, usher to the glory of God. If God blessed you to preach, preach to the glory of God. If God gave you the ability to be able to dance, dance to the glory of God. Do all that you do unto the glory of God. But now, many times, and you can ask me how I know, who's been there before. Hello? Pastor, I just want to tell you, I just can't believe what they're doing back there in the usher's room. If only you knew, Pastor. They back there playing. They back there. Now, it ain't me. Now, I'm just telling you because that's just what they're doing back there, Pastor. Now, Pastor, well, you need to, if you come right now, you can catch them in order. But now the pastor's on his date with his wife. They had a little few words. Now, he's trying to get his stuff together. Now, because you and your foolishness called, he's got to get. Baby, I got to go down to the church soon. Now, see, that caused a rift in their house. That's just the enemy. The enemy wanting to get something going in order, because see, if there's no unity in their house, there can be no unity in this house. We've got to all be able to be on one accord that God gets the glory. When you see something happening, you know what you heard, you saw what you heard. You know that they've got it out for your pastor, somebody somewhere. Instead of you going saying something to your pastor, brother, I got to tell you, man, I need you. We got to pray. We got to be on one accord for our pastor because, you know, so-and-so is trying to do this. They're trying to say that. And what you need to do, you don't have to say a word to your pastor. You come over here and you start praying for your pastor. Yeah. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray a hedge of protection around our pastor. Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, be with him and help him. So you don't need to put no more on his mind because there's enough already. And then you stand.
That's right.
You stand. And you cover your pastor. See, but many times in our churches, I want to be to keep it real, because everybody don't love the pastor. Everybody doesn't care about the pastor. They can see something coming. They can hear about something coming. And what they'll do, they'll just come and take a nice little seat. They know those jokers out to get your pastor, but yet you sit and you watch and you wait. And then when it hits, Oh, Pastor, you all right? You knew it was coming. Stop lying and faking the funk. Do what the Lord has destined you to do. Love your gift. God gave it to you. Many times, if we were to use our gifts in our church houses, we could lift each other up. We can help each other to be able to be connected one to the other as Christ connects us. Your gift may not be your brother's gift. Your gift may not be your sister's gift. But God Almighty, if you link together the gifts that God has given you and you put in your gift here, there may be some looseness in the middle right here. But if you use your gift and put it right here, and your gift and put it right here, and your gift and put it right here, what a wonder and a mightiness God can do, putting you all on one accord. You can change the atmosphere at your church house. You can change the atmosphere in your community. You can change the atmosphere in your country. God knows, and you can use the detriment of that to change the world. God created you to be world changers. But what am I to do when I can't get my pastor's attention? I want to do something to get his attention, but every time I try, it seems as though I can't get his attention. What is it that you need the pastor's attention for? Are you being fed? Are you being led? If you're being fed and led, there's really not too much that you can do except in passing tell a pastor thank you. God bless you. In this relationship of 7 years, whenever God allows pastors and congregations to come together, this should be as close to a spiritual marriage as you can get. Both pastor and congregation loving and respecting each other. Both having the best of interests at heart for the other. Even in times when you may not see things eye to eye, remember that there's a way to agree and to disagree, but still to love and respect each other. Paul writes in this 12th and 13th verse of Ephesians that God has given his church an enormous responsibility to make disciples in every nation, which involves preaching, teaching, healing, nurturing, building, among many other things, which brings us to our next point. With the overwhelming responsibility to oversee the needs of the congregation, your pastor needs each and every one of you to use the gifts or gifts that God has given you in order that you all may grow in the same direction and to be on one accord. And brother pastor, I don't mean to start no confusion or no junk in this place on today, but I'm gonna keep it real with you. I've seen it far too many times. There are many people who've got their own mess who wanna bring just to have something going. See, but God said in his word that his word shall not come back into the void. It shall accomplish everything that he sent it out to do. If there's anyone in this fellowship who has the audacity to try to do anything that is the contrary of God's will, believe you, my brother, believe you, me, my sister, God will move you out of the way that his work shall be done. You can't your pastor because of your own little selfish situations. You've got to be able to thank God if you're real about who you are and what you do. God gave you a gift. Love it. Your pastor needs each and every one of you. Each and every one of you need your pastor. But we can't be ignorant to the fact that everything is not perfect, that everybody doesn't have that right of interest at hand. And I know that many of you, I may not have hit your gear, because I know many of you probably wanted to come and jump and shout, but God sent us to teach this morning. He wants us to learn. He sent us to teach this morning, and that's what the mission we own. Is that all right, family? Is everybody all right? Y'all still like me this morning? Y'all still like, we still good? Okay, I didn't step on anybody's toes. You can say ours, but just say it real low. That's fine. That way nobody know what's going on with you. Christ is the truth, and the Holy Spirit who guides the church is the spirit of truth, according to John's writings in the 14th and 15th chapters of the book bearing his name. Satan, by contrast, is the father of lies. As followers of Christ, we must be committed to the truth. A truth and a lie cannot tarry in the same place and everything be all right. Family, if you won't be committed to the work that God has blessed you all with, along with your pastor, you got to be able to tell the truth and leave the lies alone. This means both our words and our actions should be honest, and they should reflect Christ's integrity. Speaking the truth in love is not always easy, it's not always convenient, nor is it always pleasant. But it is necessary if the church is going to do Christ's work in the world, which brings us to our third and final point. Not only is it necessary to tell the truth, but it is also necessary to keep away from lies, especially when it comes to your pastor and your church family. Can I make that plain for us on today? Have you ever known a church member, or is it you, when you went to your pastor for something and your pastor denied your request because the Lord said that it wasn't right? And you got upset with your pastor, or you knew someone who got upset with your pastor. So then you went out in the streets and you started talking to the folk whom you confided in so much. Yeah, I tell you what, pastor this and pastor that, and I don't know why pastor, and I don't know, and this, and then you tell them your business because you confide in them, because you just know they're not gonna go back and say anything. But then the next thing you know, it's brought to your attention that it's been said that you were saying these things about your pastor and your church family. But then you wonder how your business got out in the street. It's because you took it there. You told. You made jabs at your pastor and your church. Family, as your pastor goes, is how the congregation goes. If your pastor is being lifted up, your congregation is being lifted down. If your pastor is being torn down, then you're being torn down. God gets no glory. But we say that we're Christians. We love the Lord. We love our pastor. We love our church. But yet we do everything that defies the meaning of love. Love is not a four-letter word that starts with L and ends in E. Love is an action word. Even when I can't see eye to eye with my pastor, I'm going to pray for him that we can come together in love and that we can fellowship. Even when I don't believe sometimes that the pastor would do some of the things that I thought he would not have done, even if he doesn't say some of the things that I think he should say, I'm going to still love my pastor, because God gave you a gift. Love it. My mind. I just want to keep it real with you, family. You don't have to put your hand up to impress your pastor if you don't want to. I'm asking you, is your pastor preaching and teaching the word and you feel like you're growing? You don't want? Yeah. Amen. Amen. And see, in times of these, when the keyboard ain't going and the preacher hadn't hit your note yet, it'll get a little quiet sometimes. Lord, it's the pastor anniversary. I thought we'd be... God set you up this morning. And see, I could look at many of you and tell. See, we've got kingdom life. I wish that Pastor Webb and y'all would invite us back if you would like. But if you don't, we got some place to go. See, you just want to be able to keep it real. See, because many of you didn't even much respond, didn't even look up when I asked you the question, is your pastor feeding you? Is he loving you? Is he taking care of you? But I want to leave you with this. Don't go out here bad-mouthing your pastor and your church family. See, because if you're going around starting stuff and trying to get things and it got your click going or whatever, if it ain't right for you, leave. God is always in control and he's always in charge. But anyways, family, I told you I wouldn't be before you long. I'm about to close. I'm about to get up out of your head because I'm going to leave you now. But I want to leave you with just this thing. I want to get up close and personal with you for just a moment or two. I want to come down your block, on your street, up to your door. I don't mean to be nosy, but I just want to ask you a question. Has the Lord to you in these 7 years? 7 years is a long time. Seven being the completion, but eight being the number of new beginnings. Brother, pastor, and family, not to close the chapter of this for it to be closed, but to open up a new chapter for your new beginning. I want to know, has anybody been thanking the Lord for your gift? Do you thank God for the gift that He's blessed you with at this sanctuary? Well, I want to tell you something, family. Many nights when you were going through your own stuff, when you picked up the phone to call your pastor, the pastor was trying to work on other things. But because the pastor knew that you needed him, he fell down on his knees. He and his wife grabbed hands together with the children all around. The pastor prayed, "Lord, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know, but Lord, sister so-and-so was going through this. Lord, would you be with them in the midst of their situation? Lord, I call you because you put me over this congregation. Many times when you didn't have food on your table and you called your pastor in confidentiality, the next thing you know, food on your table and everything was all right. Don't you remember when mama or grandmama was in the hospital? The doctors walked away and threw their hands up. But when you called your pastor, the pastor walked into that room, started to pray, Father God, in the name of Jesus, I know that you're able, dear Lord, because I've seen you do it before. Lord, I know you can do it again. And then the next thing you know, grandmama raised her hand up. Grandmama lifted her leg up. Grandma could move a little bit. Then grandma could dance. Grandmama could run. Grandmama could run. Thank the Lord for your pastor. Don't you remember when you were going through your own mess? You couldn't seem to find your way out. Your mind was tangled. You called on your pastor. Your pastor came in. Your pastor prayed for you. And the Lord worked things out. You were able to see things going in the right direction. Thank God for your pastor. Thank God for your pastor's wife. Thank God for your pastor's children. Ain't the Lord all right? Ain't the Lord all right? Didn't the Lord work it out? Didn't the Lord work it out? Tell the Lord, thank you. Thank you for our gift, Lord. Thank you, Lord.